Hello everyone, I am Nayan Agarwal, one of the fellows at University of Florida, and we have the pleasure of talking to Dr. Deepak Bhatt from Brigham and Women, who needs no introduction. Dr. Bhatt, thank you so much for joining us on Fit on the Go.
Thank you for having me.
So we have a couple of questions for you regarding Kangaroo Law use. So when I started residency, it was about Plavix. Then it became Brilinta, Prasugrel, and now we have Kangaroo Law. So in this changing era of antiplatelets and different routes, how do we reconcile all this, and what do you think is the way to go now?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. So I think there's a role for all those medicines that you mentioned. So obviously clopidogrel and prasugrel and ticagrelor are oral agents, and the use of Kangaroo doesn't preclude use of those agents after PCI. In fact, you'd have to use one of those agents after PCI. So it's not really a battle between those classes of agents, but rather use of Kangaroo potentially in the right hospital and healthcare system environment could facilitate care. By that I mean if a patient comes in with an NSTEMI, one could consider giving that patient Kangaroo once the catheterization is done, if there's a need for PCI. And if not, if it's going to be someone who, for example, it's not coronary artery disease at all, the positive troponin was from something else, maybe they don't need any oral ADP receptor antagonist. And on the other hand, if it's surgical anatomy, and there's still in the U.S. somewhere between 10 to 15% of NSTEMI patients that go on to CABG during that index hospitalization for an NSTEMI, those patients you don't give the oral ADP receptor antagonist to, and they can go to surgery whenever their clinical condition allows and the surgical schedule allows. So I think it can facilitate care and avoid that situation of patients getting pretreated who don't really even have significant coronary artery disease, exposing them to a bleeding risk, as the ACOS trial showed does occur even with a loading dose of an oral ADP receptor antagonist. And importantly, that patient goes on to CABG, isn't just parked on the inpatient cardiology service for, you know, 3 to 5 to 7 days where all the family's asking, what's going on? How come the patient's just sitting here? You guys aren't doing anything. So I think it helps facilitate care in any number of circumstances.
So do you think with the coming guidelines and increasing use of Kangaroo, do you think pre-treatment would something which would not be class one anymore in coming times?
Well, you know, I'm not going to predict what the guideline writers will say. Kangaroo isn't even in the U.S. Mm-hmm. guidelines yet. It's just been approved too soon for the guidelines to get updated. In the European guidelines, Kangaroo is there in the most recent revision in 2015, but, you know, there it's a class 2B recommendation. So the guidelines in Europe say you can use it, but you know, not the heartiest endorsement mm-hmm. with the 2B, I suppose. So I'm not sure. And I think it depends on what a hospital's practices are. For non-STEMI patients, about half the patients in the U.S. aren't pretreated with an oral ADP receptor antagonist right now. The other half are. So it sort of depends on, you know, which type of hospital you're in. And I think there's a role for a Kangaroo that's quite intuitive in ST elevation MI, where the oral agents aren't even absorbed for the most part by the time the primary PCI is complete. And even in elective outpatient PCI, now for complex PCI with a risk of stent thrombosis and other intraprocedural thrombotic complications is higher than average, you know, there's a potential role for the drug. So, you know, I think as doctors get more use with it, they'll figure out, you know, where it is actually useful and where it isn't. Of course, in Champion Phoenix, we showed that it beat a strategy of clopidogrel pretreatment on the table. It's not that it was just similar to or non-inferior, it was actually superior to it. But one has to also factor in that it's more expensive than a strategy of pretreatment in terms of the pills versus the IV drug. Though if a patient ends up needing surgery, then there's some cost to keeping them parked in the hospital for a few days. So, you know, I think it really depends a lot on the patient and the healthcare system. I guess the doctor's own interpretation of the data and preferences, but it's another option for physicians, and I think in the right patients and the right healthcare systems, a really good option.
And one last question. So pre-treatment with Kangaroo, how does that affect your choice of oral antiplatelet after that?
Yeah, you can do whatever you want, really. So use of Kangaroo doesn't handcuff the physician in any way. You can use clopidogrel afterwards, ticagrelor, prasugrel. The only thing to know is that there are some issues with the pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics. So if you've used Kangaroo for your PCI, the 600 milligram loading dose of clopidogrel should be given at the end of the Kangalor infusion. Likewise, the 60 milligram load of prasugrel should be given at the end of the Kangalor infusion. So you've turned off the Kangalor infusion, or the nurse has turned off, and then the pills are given. With ticagrelor, in fact, you could give it during, before, after the infusion. It's a reversible oral ADP receptor antagonist, so with respect to Kangalor, there's no interaction. So if you want to give the ticagrelor in an analogous fashion at the end of the infusion, you could do it. You could give it before the patient comes if you wanted to, or you could give it during the infusion. It doesn't matter with the ticagrelor. But the clopidogrel-prasugrel interactions are important to realize. So if the Kangalor infusion's running, you don't want to at that time give clopidogrel or prasugrel, because the active metabolite will form, it will peak, and then it will disappear as the very potent infusion is still running. So that's an important point to remember.
Thank you so much, Dr. Bhatt, for talking to us today. For more such videos, you could log on to youtube.com/fitsonthego.com. Thank you so much.